the weapons of early periods were things that were used for other purposes. Often they were originally hunting weapons. So things like the spear and the knife would have been used and had other uses apart from killing other human beings or fighting other human beings. And also with axes, you could chop down a tree with an axe as well as chop someone's head off. But it's only later that when you get armies and you get a more specialist group that are full-time fighters, they need special equipment, and that's when you have the origins of weapons of war.
Metal weapons actually were the advent that led on to, or the technology that led to standing armies, to modern warfare as we can see it develop. Once the ability to cast copper bronze weapons was developed, you could then mass produce weapons. So you could then have an army, a standing army or a regular trained people in civilian street that you could call upon.
For over 1,000 years, bronze was the metal that made the weapons and armor of the Near Eastern armies. Bronze made from copper and tin was expensive. This was because both of these ores were rare, especially tin. Tin had to be mined in the few places it was found and then transported hundreds of miles before it could be used to make bronze. Bronze was cast. This meant copper and tin were heated and mixed in liquid form and then poured into a pre-made mold. Originally, these molds were used to make replicas of existing stone weapons. As early armorers mastered casting, they realized that its flexibility could lead to further improvements in their weapons.
People then caught on, why are we following the old pattern? We can actually improve the design. This technology gives us the advantage to actually increase what we can do. They then started to develop new weapons from the metal, the copper, the bronze. It could be cast. This also meant you could increase the size of your weapons, whereas a stone head or a wooden head was very limited in size and use. You could develop swords, a long weapon to use for the thrust and the slash. This affects your warfare. You are now becoming organized. You then also need armor to protect yourself from these weapons. So the weapons race is now on. Different countries developing different technologies, clashing with each other, changing their technologies and incorporating other technologies from what they've met on the battlefield. Winning or losing, you learn.
The constant battling of the Mesopotamian city-states in the 3rd millennium BC led to many breakthroughs in military technology. Perhaps the most important of these was the discovery of how to smelt iron. Iron weapons were much stronger and more durable than bronze ones. It's been suggested that Mesopotamian smiths may have learnt the secret of iron smelting as early as 2300 BC. The wish to keep this process secret meant that it took almost 1,000 years before iron was in general use throughout the Near East. When iron eventually did come into use, it had devastating effects.
The people that made one of the greatest breakthroughs and seemed to manage to keep it at extraordinary lengths were the Hittites, iron. Iron has the ability to cut through bronze and copper. This would make your swords, your spearheads, virtually useless when opposing this sort of army. The Hittites killed to protect their secret of iron. The instant people that noticed the Hittite changing technology were the Egyptians. They were quite happy wandering around with large bronze sickle-shaped swords and clashed with what was a new opposing and upcoming force, the Hittites. And the Hittite army was organized. It didn't depend on bronze, it depended on iron. And as history will tell you, the outcomers, the winners were the Hittites. They decimated the Egyptians. Warfare in those days was very brutal. There was no taking prisoners. You stood and you fought and you died. And once your army broke, you were routed. They would just follow you and kill you. the Egyptians learnt very quickly about the Hittites and iron.
The development of the war chariot was a watershed in the history of early warfare. It transformed the nature of the ancient battlefield. Its speed and maneuverability allowed its driver to divide and defeat the enemy. The speeding chariot was an unassailable foe for most infantry troops. Often the chariot would be combined with the deadly range of archers.
The mounted archer could move up to a formation very quickly, could shoot at it with their bows, and then run away more quickly than they could be chased by their infantry opponents. So if you can always stay away from your opponent, they can never hit you if you don't want to be hit, and you can always move in quickly and exploit any gap and strike them when you like, you can see why this sort of combination of mobility and archery was so effective in those early centuries BC.
The war chariot seems to have been invented by the Sumerians of southern Mesopotamia. These ingenious craftsmen of the city of Uruk first invented a sledge on which to carry their noblemen. Then they developed a sledge on rollers. Following this innovation, it was a short step to the four-wheeled cart drawn by four small horses. The four-wheeled cart developed into the faster two-wheeled version. It's been suggested that this faster vehicle was used for shepherding flocks and that this skill was later put to a military application. The selective breeding of early horses alongside the improvements in metallurgy and woodworking allowed the development of the war chariot. The two wheels of the chariot were spoked to reduce weight. In fact, the whole chariot with its harness only weighed 75 pounds.
The advantage of the chariot over cavalry is that you do not need to train so many people. You have one charioteer and you can have two or three people throwing missiles, archery, etc. Whereas one horse, one cavalryman. This way, two horses or one horse, and you've actually got three or four people able to indulge in combat. But chariots are also as much of a liability as an advantage. Large volumes of chariots that were used by the Egyptians, etc., milling around a battlefield could crash into one another, upset each other, etc. So discipline was needed. The Egyptians developed a technique where small numbers of chariots were used, 10, 25 chariots in a squadron. They may employ up to 1,500 of these chariots in one battle, but it would be done in small squadrons, everybody working under command and slowly attacking different points of the opposing army.
Chariot warfare proved hugely successful. Chariot societies overran those that didn't use them. The Hyssops took their chariots into Egypt and settled, building the city of Memphis. Aryans from Iran went east with their chariots into the Indus Valley and laid waste to the great civilization they found there. By the second millennium BC, so many societies had learnt of the war chariot's value that it was a common feature of battle all across the Near East. The successful use of the chariot wasn't confined to the Near East. The Celts of Northern Europe also utilized their mobility. In contrast to the Sumerians' light chariot, the Celts' chariot was more sturdy in construction. This may be explained by the way in which it was used.
The main objection of the Celtic chariot was to smash into your opposing battle lines. Yes, they would be used as a missile center, but they were there. They were a heavier construction than the Egyptians, the Assyrian chariots. They were there to actually punch holes in the opposing line. Once that's happened, the army's running around in disorganization. It's easier for your troops to attack them. I wouldn't say it was comparable to a modern-day battle tank, but the psychological effect on the opposing troops, seeing this heavy machine hurtling down on you,